there is one posture called peacock posture that you will be balancing your whole abdomen on your just two hands.
Right.
So I was trying, I couldn't do. So one day, our director of the ashram was taking the class, so he hardly takes the class there.
Okay.
So then he told me, do this, that, and in 5 minutes I was in that posture.
Oh, wow.
Which I couldn't do since last couple of months, he made me do in 5 minutes. So I was saying, so there I learned, like understood how everything works with our system.
There's something, you know, very much rare about this session, and that's the reason why I'm excited. To start with, firstly, happy Ganesh Chaturthi to everyone. And this is for the first time that we are getting someone who is from Kerala, from the God's own land. Otherwise, we have earlier got a lot of people from a lot of places, be it, you know, states from UP, Bihar, Orissa, Punjab, Uttarakhand, everywhere. But this is for the first time when we are actually getting someone, and he's from Kerala. And he's a rare mix of talent if I talk about. So, a person who is a fashion enthusiast, a person who is an artist, and a person at the same time, he is a yoga guru, a yoga coach. And if I talk about his journey, the way he has marked his step of, you know, putting his first step to yoga and then heading on to take a headstand in itself is praiseworthy. So going live with none other than wandering_Tarjan, that's the fancy business, and his name is Abhinand TR, and he is joining us live with me through Lehza.in, and I'm sure that you guys will hi Abhinand, namaskaram, that's in the Kerala
good
style.
Evening.
Good evening, that's in the Kerala style that we do.
Namaskaram.
Namaskaram. So I was telling everyone that, you know, why I'm excited, because, you know, I have got guests, I have got people from across India, from all the states, but this is for the first time that I'm actually getting someone from Kerala, from the God's own land, and that's you here for the first time.
The pleasure is all mine.
I am actually, you know, it's my privilege to sit with you and, you know, talk about your lifestyle, talk about your journey. So I'll just briefly tell everyone about Abhinand. So Abhinand is, like I was telling, he is a rare mix of talent, which I have already mentioned about him earlier, because he has been my college mate, a wonderful friend of mine. And at the same time, if I talk about his journey, if I briefly tell about him, so he joined into a fashion college to become a designer. He was an artist. He is an artist, you know, a fashion enthusiast, then an artist. And then finally, he jumps into fitness for life, and he starts training yoga for himself first. And today, he is a wonderful yoga coach, a yoga teacher. And there are people under him who they go and spread out yoga or, you know, fitness for life across, taken classes, and he has been honored and celebrated by other countries as well. So, Abhinand, this is all that, you know, probably I would have been able to briefly tell to everyone, all my audience. But why don't you go ahead and talk more about and elaborate about things about yourself?
So, from where you want me to start?
Maybe, I'm sure people would love to start with, if you start with something from your childhood, maybe, like, you know, that's the transition. That's what, you know, if you are into something, or if there is something in your mind, a kind of interest or a passion or a hobby, I suppose you have that from your childhood that keeps on building up, and then it comes all of a sudden, you know, you have a free hand. So maybe.
So if I start from my childhood, I never had an idea to become a yoga teacher or make yoga into my part of my life. So
being
a child, I was always a hyperactive kid, and I used to always run around with, like, I had given enough headaches to my parents and few people around my house also. I always used to be a destructive person, to be honest. So pretty much I was not into anything else other than doing cricket or anything like that. But when I come in the case of cricket, 24/7, like, once I get go into the school, there, whenever I get a break, I make the team with the friends and go out and like, we don't need any like actual bat or ball to play.
Right,
we will
right.
make anything.
Correct.
Yeah. And once I'm back, like after 4:30, the first thing, like my mom will force me to eat something. I will take a couple of bites and I will run to play. So that's all what I used to do. So after a certain time, I just moved from that, like after age of like 15 or something like that. I mean, then I had to change from that part to another part.
Correct.
So then the front circle changes, so all those things changes with the like playing part. But then like they here I come, how I ended into the yoga is like the first time, it was when I was 15. So I had this breathing issue. So you might have heard about the bacteria eosinophilia.
Yeah, right, right. Eosinophilia.
Yeah,
that's true.
Yeah, it's a good bacteria in our system.
Correct.
Yeah, yes, yes, you're saying something.
So I was saying that, you know, when I have been through eosinophilia, like I was eosinophilic because of that. I have been asthmatic in like, you know, in my symptoms. So even
yes,
I got
yes,
into that
yes.
yoga thing to cure myself.
Yes.
That's what I have experienced.
Yes, yeah. yes. Good, good. So yeah, I don't have how to explain much that you can understand
yeah,
that.
Yeah, yeah.
So actually, it was after the 10th exam board exam break.
Okay.
So my father wanted to send me to an ashram to like learn yoga so that I can cure all my breathing problems.
Okay.
So I said, okay, I will go. But his idea was to cure my illness.
Right.
But honestly, my idea was something else. Because the 10th result will be out in few days.
Okay.
I need a place to run away.
Right.
That was one idea. And second thing, to be honest, a yogi shouldn't say this. But my dad's younger brother, so he is also a like yogi. Now, right now, he is not just yogi. He does Reiki, Pranic Healing, Tai Chi, all those things he does. He is completely into that. So. But so this thing that I'm talking like when he got married, so that was around some 20-25 years before.
Okay.
So he was in some place studying yoga and he found his love of his life from there.
Okay.
And she is from London.
Okay.
So
okay.
I was always fond into that if I go and practice yoga, I can have an English girlfriend. I mean, like, why do you
that's nice. That's nice. That's crazy, man. It's crazy of your thought.
Yeah.
But anyways, that's true. I mean, it has happened with lot of us. Like, you know, if you do this or, you know, if you travel at this place, you might be able to get a wife like that. Everybody has that thought, early thoughts. That's true.
They say about my health problem, I could not sleep properly in the night. Like, if I lie down, my nose will get blocked in the night.
Right.
But after practicing your pranayama, the breathing technique, and just Surya Namaskar and tall yoga postures every single day, it completely changed in 45 days.
Oh, wow.
So,
nice.
So then I understand what actually this pranayama is.
Hmm.
So when we just say the word pranayama, it's just some breathing technique.
Right.
Most of the people think.
Right.
So, basically the word, that's a Sanskrit word which means prana plus ayama.
Ayama, right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes. So, prana means our life force and ayama means controlling it. So, basically just by breathing, we are like balancing our internal energy, like balancing our right and left hemisphere of our brain and the whole body.
Nice.
Then we are balancing the heating and cooling elements in our system. So
there is
tridosha called Vata, Pitta and Kapha. So Vata is the cooling element, it is get hyper in our system. That's why we have this problem that our nose will get, and only this happens only in the night. So we need to balance and reverse the process.
Correct.
So when the heating element is more activated in our system, this problem doesn't happen inside our system.
Right.
So again, just with the pranayama, it again balances the heat and cold element in our body.
Right.
Again, it has the ability to completely calm our system.
Even if
I was a hyperactive person, I just sit and breathe for a few rounds, just few rounds of anulom vilom, the alternate nostril breathing.
Right.
So after like 5 to 10 rounds, I'm completely calm and relaxed. So then I understand. It's again, it's not just the physical aspect that we see. It's just completely different. So then I left the idea of getting the European girlfriend and
then you finally shifted from your mindset, moved from okay, fine, yoga is not only about getting a European girlfriend but also about fitness and fitness in all aspects. That's so true, really true. And to some extent I would connect for this part, because you know, I remember in my early school days even I had faced these issues because it's not filling. And because of that, you know, people say, hey, you are not supposed to eat curd, you're not supposed to eat egg, lot of restrictions were there. And I used to eat everything, but all I used to tell everyone that main to anulom vilom karta hun, like, you know, I do anulom vilom selfie. So that was one of the things. Another nice thing which I, you know, for the first time I learned from you is when you said pranayam, so it means the force of life, and ayam means balancing it. So that's a lovely term and lovely phrase that I have learned today. Anyway, so this is something which I realized, Abhinand, that, you know, you probably at that time, you got a tinge of what yoga is and what difference it can make in your life. But I believe after your school, then you, after your school, I'm sure you got into college. And that time you were more into focused towards being a designer. You were a fashion enthusiast. I remember you used to go out for shoots, photo shoots. You had your own catalog of your photo shoots. You are a wonderful artist. So, a little bit about that, you know, how did that happen? And then probably we can go ahead with...
Actually, like the yoga, these things only happen for like next few years. Like after the age of 50, then as you said, when right before I enter into the school, so I like plus one and plus two, like 11th and 12th standard. So till that time, yoga was like some part of my life. And another thing fascinated me was the asanas also, like just different postures, diplomatic postures. That what attracted me in the doing postures is before, like I always used to sit or stand with a hunchback. So naturally that gave me a like upper back hunch. And then because of that, I couldn't do the headstand, shirshasana for 2 years. I had to straighten that to do the shirshasana, and that took me 2 years. So there I understood like what just a simple sitting posture can do to the direction of your muscle. But because of that I continued doing that for a few years.
So when you joined NIFT, so I remember your, you know, since we have been the college mates, so I remember your phase of that life, you know, that phase of your life where you joined NIFT, you were a wonderful artist. We have seen a lot of your sketches, your artworks, and your fascination towards getting into styling, like styling yourself, getting the shoots done. And then all of a sudden, one day, the story that I told you, I got to, you know, I heard from a friend of yours. I think that's a common friend we have, Akhil, you would be knowing him. So one day, randomly, I was sitting with Akhil, and Akhil told me that, dude, you know about Abhinand? He has become a yogi. I was like, surprised, seriously? Then he showed me some of your pictures. And to my surprise, I just can't believe that, you know, some of your pictures that I saw where you are doing some really tough, robust poses of yoga. You know, it was astounding in itself to believe that. And that's seriously, because, you know, I know it might be on your fingertips, Abhinand, but it's as hard as hell for anyone, any other one, you know, the second person to do that. So looking at those pictures, I just had one question. How all of a sudden, you know, from designing, you moved, you know, you left the, you dropped out of the college and then you got into yoga all of a sudden. How that, a part of your journey?
So, that's what I was about to say. So, as soon as I left NIFT, I was completely blank. What to do with my life? So, then I thought, why shouldn't I go back to ashram and stay there? In between also, like, you remember that I dropped NIFT like a couple of times. So, one of that 6 months, I had done TTC also. But TTC again, that was teacher's training course from one ashram. So, that was again like a 1 month course. And it was again, not, I was not planning to teach at all. So, my father sent me there. So, you just enjoy and like, it, like new experience. It was completely staying there in ashram for 45 days, that in a completely new routine. So So he was saying that when you are in Bangalore, you don't have any structured life. So go there, stay there for this many days and have a structured life in your system. Structured system in your life, sorry.
Correct.
Yeah. So I went there, so we had to get up early in 5:30 in the morning, 6 o'clock. We start with the meditation, then for 1 hour we will be chanting. Then by 8 o'clock we will start the practice for 2 hours. And then 10 o'clock we will be having breakfast. And then another important factor we just over there is called Karma Yoga. Huh. So Karma Yoga is something like you have to do something in the ashram. Hmm. It can be anything.
Okay.
But you shouldn't expect anything. So it's like a selfless service that we have to do.
Right.
It can might be cleaning the whole premises, can be cleaning the dormitory or bathroom or clearing the waste bin. Or
right.
Some days it can be food serving, or it can be anything in the ashram. So the basic idea is to kill your ego.
Hmm.
So it's not like only white collar job that you should do.
Right.
You have a lot of options right around you. Just
right.
Because nowadays people have concept that you have to sit in a chair which will be rotating and you have to always sit and type throughout the day.
Correct.
So most of the people have that kind of idea about their, like how their life should move on.
Right.
So yeah, then after Karma Yoga again we will be having a philosophical lecture class for like a couple of hours and Bhagavad Gita is there. So and then again the whole like evening also practice, dinner at 6 o'clock, again evening meditation and chanting happens. So it continued for 30 days. But yeah, at that time there was a structure. So then again came back to NIF, but again I couldn't cope up with the whole thing. So I dropped it, completely dropped it after that time. So then I was sitting and thinking, okay, then why shouldn't I go back and stay there for a few months as a staff over there?
Correct.
So that's how I went back to ashram. So that was also to get back an idea or understanding about myself.
So,
and that's the first time that I started teaching over there for the first time. So, and then I understood like more about our physical part, like the muscle, direction of the muscle.
Right.
And as you mentioned few minutes before,
right.
that you told that whatever postures that I do can might be difficult for someone else to do.
Right.
But no, I will say no. It's
okay.
About how you does it. It matters.
Okay.
So you know there is one posture called peacock posture.
Okay.
That you will be balancing your whole abdomen on your just two hands.
Right.
So I was trying. Yeah. I was trying even when I was in the ashram, and I was trying and for months I couldn't do. So one day our director of the ashram was taking the class, so he hardly like takes the class there.
Okay.
So because of some staff shortage, he was taking the class over there that day.
Hmm.
And I asked him, told him that I'm trying this and I couldn't do this.
Mm-hmm.
Then he told me, do this, that and in 5 minutes I was in that posture.
Oh wow.
Which I couldn't do since last couple of months.
Right.
He made me do in 5 minutes.
5 minutes.
So that I was saying. So there I learned, understood how everything works with our system.
Correct.
Internally and externally.
Right.
So
right.
And I had seen many people coming over there, like different health conditions they
correct.
Have.
Correct.
And everyone gets cured or maybe not completely cured. Or like 95% to 70-80% cure they are happening.
Correct.
And I was thinking, why shouldn't I also? I already have a teacher's training course, TTC I have. Then why shouldn't I start doing this? But at that point of time, I was not good enough, like with teaching or something like that, because I don't have much understanding. So I was completely in the basic. So then I moved on to Mysore to learn more advanced sections
yoga.
Of the, it's called Ashtanga. Ashtanga series. So what I was doing over here was completely basic, like Hatha Yoga. Then I moved to Mysore to learn my much of like Ashtanga and how all the body works and how we can make someone do something very easily. So all those things that I learned over there. And yes, then I got more interested, like after I was saying about cricket, now yoga became an addiction to me.
Okay, that's a good thing now.
Like,
you know what, Abhinav? So, like, in the last 5 minutes, what you have spoken, there are a few things that I want to highlight. I want to make this up for everyone who will be looking at this video. one thing that you mentioned about your dad, that he asked you to go to the ashram, and he mentioned a very beautiful point to you, that we need to first structure our life, and that's very important. Once we go to such divine places, I'm sure that, you know, the discipline that we develop, that discipline structures our life. And when we have a discipline in our life, we are into a habit of looking within ourselves. That you mentioned that you realize what's your potential, what might be your passion, what are your resources. And you realize that it's not designing maybe, rather it's fitness for life that you wanted to get into. And you finally jumped into a, you know, elevated from a basic level to an advanced level of yoga, moving, you know, to another state, another city. So that's something which I realized. Really nice. So
So as I was saying, the whole path journey of my yoga was not planned by myself. Like, it all came. Like,
it all happened.
The life pushed me there.
Correct.
Yeah.
So Avirandha, I understand this, you know, your journey now. I got a clear picture that, you know, definitely by the series of events you had in your life, you got into yoga. But then one thing is yoga for yourself. Another thing is ensuring that you are also flourishing or teaching yoga, or, you know, you are patronizing yoga to an extent that you are called by other countries and they celebrate you there. You have seen your pictures where you are on stage and people are actually honoring you. So that's the reason I said that it's my privilege to have you here. So how did that happen? You know, from a person who is training for oneself, for yourself, and then you start training others. So that level of your yoga, I wanted to understand that briefly, if you can.
So, as you know me, I'm not a person who always stays at one point. I will be like moving around. So, initially how it was, like after like studying all those things, I came back to Kerala and I actually started a yoga center in Kerala.
That's
but, you know, when people like started learning, they have a basic idea that of everything. So everyone want to learn the things very quickly. But yoga is not something that you can learn in short time. So the first, when they are coming to me and first thing they will be asking me like, is in how many days I can learn yoga? You'll be like, no, you cannot.
That's true.
So gradually, Initially, it was not a big success. So I run the yoga studio and I had to pay a big amount for the yoga center. It was owned by someone else. So I was just renting the place. So I was not making any profit out of that. And I was putting too much energy and time into that. And nothing was like working out. So I just moved out. Then I thought, why shouldn't I move around and see who actually needed. So if I stuck at a one place and expect who like needy to come towards me. So it will not happen like that. So then I thought like, why shouldn't I move around? So then I started like going to different ashrams. So from there, different ashrams and like different kind of places where like people gather. So I connected with different people and different organizations. So when they pretty much liked my attitude, and I mean, it's not just my attitude. We all like who does this into this path. I don't know how like they all connect to each other with somehow like in that. I must say it's the frequential vibration that creates when we chant Om and all. So you know that 432 hertz is the frequential vibration of Om. So that's again the frequency of all the life creation, which is like 6 hertz and 8 hertz. So all the life is created in that vibration. So when we chant Om, so all these things uplift and we will automatically get connected from one person to another person.
That's resonation, right?
Even that, that
resonation. We use a resonation is the term, if I'm not wrong, that we use. When people are you know, pronouncing the same thing at one point of time. And normally we say, even I mean, I won't say that I come from a yogi background, but I have seen a lot of people around, you know, me that, and in my families also, So they'll wake up at 4 in the morning, 5 in the morning. And my hometown is, it's next to River Ganga, Ganges. So they will go there and they practice this, you know, traditional way of working out. Not exactly yoga, but Vyam, you understand, Vyam is a word in North India where, you know, you do physical exercises. Vyam.
Yes,
so there
they
do this, you know, pronouncing of Om. So Om is that word that you even said. And it's in the Brahma Muhurt that they do. Early morning.
Yeah.
Brahma Muhurt is like 4 o'clock wala hour in the morning. So
you know what's the importance of Brahma Muhurt?
I have heard, like, you know, I mean, I can't really be as proper as you, but what I have heard is that it's the time when everything is silent, and it's the time right before, you know, the dawn, you say, the early morning. So it's the, you have the positive vibe. So that's what I know. What is exactly as for you? If you can tell me.
As you said, it will be silent.
Yeah.
So one sensory organ, ear, will be completely taken away from your mind.
Nice.
It will be, the air will be completely pure.
Right.
So the breath that you take in will be completely pure.
Right.
It will be dark.
Right.
The another sensory organ is again calmer.
Right.
So, and most of the people won't be talking to each other at that time. Like, you are up like early in the morning and you are silent.
Correct.
Again, that sensory organ is not working.
Right.
So basically, and when you get up at that time, all your sensory organs are drawn completely inward.
Right. So
and
true.
Another thing is the gravitational pull of the moon is going away from the earth.
Okay.
And the sun is rising, like starting from the equator.
Right,
so the
right.
energy of the sun is coming towards the planet and the energy of the moon is going away from the planet. So both the energies are available at that time.
Correct.
But if we have to absorb that energy into the system, our spine have to be completely perpendicular to the ground. So you might have seen 7 chakras in our
Correct.
System, right?
Right.
And the topmost chakra. Yeah. So the topmost chakra is at the crown of your head.
Oh.
So only when if you are straight, it will absorb through the crown of the head.
Correct.
This energy. So you have to be up and awake. That's why Brahma Muhurta is very important. So you will get that energy. But you, to absorb that energy, you have to be up and awake. And that's the same idea of Shivaratri also, like not sleeping throughout the night. Most of the Shivaratri will be happening in a full moon day, where lunar energy is more and keeping you awake. The keeping the spine, basically keeping the spine straight is the whole idea is to asking to stay awake so that you can absorb that positive energy.
Correct.
Yes.
That's so true, man. So when you were actually talking about this, I realized ki, you know, even in my days, in my hometown, I've seen a lot of people, you know, practicing this kind of Vyam in that Brahma Muhurt, in that early morning hours. So that's one thing. So now hearing about that entire, you know, you shifting places, you know, traveling places. Now I have one question for you. Is it the reason why your handle is wandering_tarzu?
Wandering. So wandering Tarzan, yes. So I never like constantly stay at one place. I will be moving from one place to another place. That's why it's wandering.
Correct.
And why Tarzan is like, you know that, the Tarzan is someone who always like to live with the nature.
Correct.
And jungle,
that Tarzan guy, exactly, that jungle guy. So
that's
pretty much, you know, when if somebody will look at your profile, if they browse your pictures, I'm sure they will realize that, you know, how often you travel, and looking at all your you know, resilient poses that you frame in your pictures, that one of that peacock thing that you said, I believe most of your pictures are where you are with just two hands. You have taken a stand on a piece of stone, on a round stone. Then I think those places are from abroad, wherever you have traveled. So that was one thing that's really that's fascinating for everyone if they browse your profile. Between Avin and Sis, we have.
And do you know that?
Yeah, go ahead.
No, I was just saying. You know that how much I like to jump around like that.
That's true. But that's a good thing. That's a good thing about you, that, you know, you are so fit in your life and you are embracing fitness and you're spreading out that fitness across, to your peer ones. So since we have a time constraint, you know, there are a few things that I have to discuss with you. One thing is that you know, you mentioned about some ashrams or some camps that you had been part of, you know, like Dharna Foundation you mentioned. That's one thing that I want to talk to you for now. Post that, I want to understand about your healthy habits that you practice. Like you mentioned about your sleeping habits, your discipline, your food. So if you can briefly talk about that and spread out that awareness to people.
Yeah. So as I was saying, I just got connected with different organizations and ashrams. So whenever they have some functions like kids camp, even like kids camps are there. So all the kids will be completely detached from the parents and they will be coming to the ashram and staying with us.
Right.
So we will be taking care of them. So for a few weeks, we are their guardian. So how they get attached to us, and most of them will be like 7 to 12 years old.
Right,
so you know that how hard it is for them to get detached from their parents and come to a new environment.
Correct.
So initial few days will be completely tough for them. And because of their emotions also, it will be more emotional for us also. But gradually we make a connection over there.
Correct.
And by the end of the time where they have to leave after 3 or 4 weeks, they don't want to leave only. They just want to be there with us more than going with their parents. So those kind of attachments that we make. And so what I was saying about, yeah, the Dharma Foundation. So once as we had done one camping in a place called Jagayapet, it's in Andhra Pradesh.
Okay.
So mainly we were concentrating in women and kids.
Okay.
So women, we used to like talk to like different people and we will used to guide them with, they have like different physical conditions. So as we know that most of the women are not like into all this business. Fitness things, basically it's in a village.
That's a major concern that actually I wanted you to discuss more on this. Along with Dharna Foundation, if you can tell us, you know, how much you consider that fitness is required today when it comes to Indian women, when it comes to kids, still I understand, but Indian women mainly who are not going out of their house. So, you know, it's not possible for Indian women to get into a rigorous training. So how is yoga helping them? Or you know, so you can also talk about that post your Dharna Foundation thing. Please, go ahead.
Yes. So, about that. So, in yoga, what I am showing, it's just some circles, to be honest. So, you don't have to go all the way for that.
Right.
For every posture, every posture, there is some alternative that you can do and get the same benefit.
Correct.
Minimal physical movement.
Correct.
So, but most of the people, as I said, in the village, most of the women are like not aware about, like there is something called fitness stuff are there. They are not aware at all. They are just completely stuck with their family. It's because we are not providing those kind of ideas towards them. If I must say, we should be like doing like more of these kind of campaigns at like different places of the rural areas of our country, which we can give a better idea to them. And most of the women are struggling nowadays. The PCOD is like a major issue among all the women, especially after they are delivering a baby. And so whoever I talked about there had this issue. And we were just training them. With 5 to 6 postures, we can change everything if they are practicing regularly. And you know, Surya Namaskar, Sun Salutation, just 2, 3 to 4 rounds every day. And if they can take out that much time in their daily routine, they can have a like fit life and more healthier and happy life if they have that time to get up little early and do a couple of rounds of pranayama, and their mind will be more grounded and balanced and all. And again, with the same thing, with the kids also. So it's not like we should force them to do it or something. We can also make them into a playful way also. Like, we don't have to actually tell them we are doing yoga.
Right.
We are like, so we will make them do like, imagine tree posture. So we will tell them like a story, like there was one tree. And so you are like, now you all are going to act like a tree. And you will be standing like a tree. And then the wind is moving. Then the tree posture will start like waving. Then the voice of the tree will be going. And then you go all to like the because of the force of the tree, you fell down, and then you go straight away to Shavasana.
right.
Or this kind of things happen. So you don't have to actually tell them, like when they are small, you don't have to tell them you are doing a physical practice. You are playing.
You are just playing.
They actually enjoy that kind of stuff. So we were training few of the kids like that also. And there, as I was saying, there was one school like that we went. That was a government school in Jagayapeta. So it's Andhra Pradesh. So every morning, like 5:30, we were there. So first couple of days, everyone was like little hesitant to get up, you know, how kids like to sleep early in the morning. So first few days, they were hesitated to do all the practice, but their warden were like pushing them, and all the kids were from like different families. Like most of the people, like the 90% of them had no exposure to the external world, or like how, you know, how it goes in a rural area.
Correct.
Most of them were from a very poor family.
Correct.
And so like yoga and all those things were like a completely new and fresh experience for them. So first few days they were like looking at us like an alien who came to disturb them.
That's true. Yes, it's a kind of
all these fashion elements actually helped me with all the kids. To be honest, among all the people, they were looking at me because I had this piercing and different kind of earrings I have. So they were looking and they were actually curious to come towards me and to So yeah, whenever I was in the class and like they were like. Another girl also, she was 5C. So she used to be like too fair and like too white she is. So even like with her, the kids are like, oh, if we practice yoga, we will be like her. So
So it's like more of the storytelling that you are talking about. So when you are with, you know, into a training camp with the kids, so you have to side story.
Yeah.
So that's another wonderful thing that, you know, that you have told me just now, which I will again call that out also. That if you are training the kids, storytelling is very important, be it anything that we are into training. So don't have to tell them that you are teaching them yoga. Rather, you make them do some, you know, play some games with them, like asking them to, can you stand like a tree? And then make them stand like a tree on one single leg with raising their hands. And in case if they fall, you tell them that ye to savasana, this is savasana. So it's actually a nice story. And the, you know, the kids are able to get into the yoga practice and you cite the entire story.
Yeah.
It's a perfect example. That's true. Okay, Avinand, post this, you know, understanding about all your foundation, I mean, all your yoga camps that you have done. Can you a little bit talk about your serene and, you know, more of your strict discipline and the lifestyle that you have developed these days? Because you told me that these days you have dinner before sunset. So the moment you said, I was like, here, I have an Akshay Kumar in a friend. So that's a good thing to talk about. Akshay Kumar is an actor. Once I remember one of his interview, what he said is that he doesn't have dinner post 8 and he goes to sleep. He goes to the bed by 8 or 9 latest. And hits 4 o'clock. He hits the beach at 4 o'clock in the morning. So when you said that, I was like, do you have a similar lifestyle these days?
Yeah, no, I mean, I have 4:30 plus in the morning, so I start my day by getting up four. So definitely I had to get to my, So even like I go to bed around 9:30, 10, and I finish my dinner before sunset.
That's
so
nice.
I will tell you like why we have to eat before sunset. So you might have heard about nadis, the energy channels in our system.
Right.
So, okay. So before that, let me tell you the three aspects of our human body.
Okay.
So imagine our body is like a robot. So our physical body is the machine with all the wires and all the machineries. So it's a complicated machine. That's the most complicated machine in the whole universe, I must say.
Right.
So that's our physical body. But this physical body, to this machine to work, there need to be one electricity or battery, the current.
Correct.
That's our soul, the Atma that we call, or the pranic energy that I must say in the language of yoga.
Correct.
But only with the electricity and with the machine, the robot won't work. That need a coding, a programming should be there.
Right, that's our mind.
So, as I was saying about the pranic energy, the soul, so even the current inside the robot will be moving to some particular channels, energy channels, right? That wiring should be there for the to connect from one organ to another. So these all are the imaginary lines. You cannot see all the nadis. It's the path of energy channels, like the way through where the energy will be moving from one part to another.
Correct.
So that's the energy channel. There are 72,000 energy channels in your system. So those are the nadis. 72,000 nadis are there in your... Yeah.
Okay. My goodness. Yeah. Nice.
So among them, three are very important ones: Ida, Pingala, and Sushumna. So Sushumna is the central nervous system.
Come again. Ida.
Ida. Pingala.
Okay.
And Sushumna.
Sushumna. Okay.
Yeah. So Sushumna is goes at through the center of our spine, or called it by modern medical science. You okay. know, we know that there is a central nerve system, right?
Right.
So
right.
it goes along with that.
Okay.
So Sushumna Nadi is going along with the central
nerve system, right?
Yeah. And yes, and Ida and Pingala is coiling from one direction toward, from the base of the spine towards the crown of the head
right,
and
yeah.
the one Ida will coil this way and Pingala will be coiling in the opposite direction. From the
right.
base of the yeah so from the base of the spine it goes to one goes to the right brain, other goes to the left brain.
Right, yeah.
So that balance the right and left hemisphere of the brain. And another job of Ida and Pingala is, when I was saying very initially how the Nadi Shodhana balances the heat and cold element inside your system.
Right.
So, Ida and Pingala, what it does, another name for Ida and Pingala is Surya Nadi and Chandra Nadi. Surya is the sun and Chandra is the moon.
Right.
One is the, that one gets activated when the sun is up, and another, the Chandra Nadi gets activated
when the moon is up. Right.
Yeah. So now I will tell you like what Chandra Nadi is doing with your system. So whenever the sun is up, the Chandra Nadi is activated, and that activates all the heating elements inside your system, and that absorbs energy from whatever you do. It can be the energy we might be absorbing from the sun, and it might be whatever you breathe, and it can be whatever you eat or drink. So throughout the day, it's storing the energy inside your system. And whenever the sun is up, and the moon is up, then the Chandra Nadi gets activated. So what Chandra Nadi is doing is using the same energy from the morning, whatever the Surya Nadi had made that energy channel, I mean that energy that produced throughout the day is converted to reheal our system throughout the night.
Correct.
So when you eat after 6 o'clock, so when I said all the heating elements, your digestive system is one of the heating elements. After 6 o'clock, it's not working properly at all.
Right.
Whatever you eat after 6 in the night, it's always.
It's always.
So it will be... So actually, the actual digestion is not happening. So when I say digestion, everything has to be broken into vitamins, minerals, proteins, or essential potassium, sodium. Everything has to be separated from the food, and that has to be absorbed into our system.
Correct.
So that is not actually happening after 6 o'clock. So when the Surya Nadi is not active, everything is converted into fat and deposited as different parts of your body.
Correct.
And you are not getting any benefit out of the food that you consume.
Correct.
And the body forcefully tries to digest it, and whatever energy that is stored from the morning is taken away again after whenever you eat, and you are not getting the energy for the Chandra Nadi to reheal your system. So that happens if you eat after 6. And now, why to sleep early? I said the Chandra Nadi is getting activated. So to function the Chandra Nadi properly, your whole body has to be in a complete relaxing state.
Right.
That means you have to sleep. Shut yourself
early.
Completely down.
Sleep early.
And imagine. You slept by 10 o'clock, you are sleeping, but you ate your dinner at 9 o'clock. So most of the food will take minimum 4 to 5 hours for the digestion.
Correct.
So still internally your digestive system is working. And you are trying to sleep. Actually you are not sleeping, you are just lying down and relaxing there. Then again the Chandra Nadi is reheal the of our system is not happening at all. So that's why you have to eat before sunset and sleep around like 8 to 9. And another thing with the modern science, the most amount of the morphine is secreted between 10 p.m. and 2 a.m. in the night. So if you are sleeping at like the morphine is like a healing enzyme inside our system. So if you sleep at that right time, you will be, your system is getting healed and you will stay young. You will never grow old, to be honest.
that's a nice thing, man. That's something which I want to tell everyone, you know, through this video, that, you know, first thing, there are a few call outs actually through this entire video, is through our entire session, is one thing, the discipline that you mentioned about while you went to an ashram. So that discipline, that structure in life. Second call out was when you spoke about the Brahm Muhurt and the importance of Brahm Muhurt, and you very well explained about all those, you know, five sensory organs that we have and how it starts working internally, inwards and not outwards during that Brahm Muhurt, the importance of Brahm Muhurt. Plus all the nadis that you explained and why, you know, you as a, you know, individually, you know, you as a person, when you eat before sunset and you sleep by 8 and 9 o'clock. So why is this important? And the wonderful explanation that you had. So that's something, again, you know, through this video, I would call out that if you eat before sunset, our digestive systems, is it's a heating process and it works better before sunset. And post sunset, the Chandra Nadi that you explained, so that starts working. It's a healing process for the body. So the body needs to be relaxed. So as per, you know, yoga, or I mean, actually as per any other medical science, so 10 p.m. to 2 a.m. is the right time when somebody should sleep. But ironically, I believe these days there are very few, I would, you know, it's not even easy to, it's hardly there anyone who would be practicing this kind of lifestyle. But since you do, hats off to you. It's praiseworthy, Abhinandan, I'm sure.
most of the people sleep that after 2 o'clock.
Right. For that matter, even I would be guilty about the fact that even I normally go to sleep at 12, 1 o'clock and nothing before that. So that's true that, you know.
But the problem is, as I was saying, you all might have heard that you should eat before sunset and sleep early. We all heard about that.
Correct.
From our parents or our grandparents. Mm. But if we ask them why, they don't have an explanation. That's the basic thing, that we are not following it.
Correct,
but if we know this exactly why we have to do it, we will definitely follow
it. That's so true. So
yeah,
this is a wonderful takeaway that we had from you, Abhinandan, today. So I'm sure that people will be watching this video later. They will get an understanding and an idea about what is yoga, why is it important for everyone in their life. And importantly, there were a few points that you mentioned about how is yoga going to help, you know, regular people in a regular life, so especially the women of our country. So they need this.
So
Arumit is asking about explanation were missing. Oh, that's true, that the explanation were missing in the regular life of people. So now, you know, when people get to know exactly. So even I wasn't aware about that, you know, different kind of asanas that you explained. You know, why is it important? What are the roles? You know, all the seven chakras that you mentioned about, starting from your crown of the head, going till the end of the spinal cord. So all these explanations that you have given, I'm sure this is a wonderful takeaway for everyone who will be watching this video.
And what I talked today was like some 0.00001% of whole yogic science. Very, very basic.
I'm thinking that even if somebody, what you have said is 0.00001% of the entire yoga theory that we have, and even out of this 0 to 1%, if somebody is able to grab 1% out of this 0 to 1%, I'm sure they will have a healthy life. And
definitely
not just the physical fitness, definitely it will also get a mental fitness, like you have anyways mentioned that, you know, ultimately these are connected, the entire system. When you explain the nadi system, that one, you know, balances your left hemisphere of the brain, the other balances the right hemisphere. So in itself it explains that yoga is not just for the physical fitness or for, you know, one system of the body, rather it's for the entire system. And your wonderful explanation,
yoga, the word yoga itself means union of your mind, body and soul.
Union of your mind, body and soul. Wow. Wow.
Yeah.
This is wow. So I was actually looking for a blooper for your video. Now I have got. So yoga means the union of the mind, body and soul. And going back to that conversation we had when you told about imagine our body to be a robot. So you need a battery system. You need a power. That's our Atma. And then, you know, you told that we need someone to manage that. So that's our mind. That's brain. And
that memory, yeah.
That memory and that.
No. It's not just in your brain. The memory is fed in each and every cell in your system.
Right.
That's where the muscle memory happens.
The muscle memory, correct. And then the third one, that was a brilliant way of explanation. So coding, yeah, exactly. Yeah. Arumit has mentioned that's so true. So, anyways, Arum, Abhinand, so I really had a great time, and you know, I had like literally great takeaways from you when it comes to yoga as a practice. And I'm sure post this, looking at you, everybody should, you know, they will. I mean, I'm sure that, you know, as a yoga coach, you have a lot of followers and you are doing a wonderful job. But I believe that even if I'm able to get, you know, few people through this Lehza profile who starts practicing yoga in their life and they are able to understand the importance of yoga, I think I'm doing my job. And
Definitely. And yeah, well, one more thing that you asked me so far. So now I will ask you. I wanted to ask you, what's the meaning of Lehza?
Lehza means the way how people talk. Lehza is a word that explains everybody has a tone of talking, a way of talking. So that what's Lehza means. So this is my Lehza, how I
talk. That's Hindi?
It's an Urdu word. Okay.
Urdu.
So Instagram says I have just 1 minute 20 seconds remaining to end this video.
Okay.
So, you know, since it goes to, it would be, you know, end up in the middle of the thing. So let's try and end this up here, this entire session. Once again, thank you so much, Abhinand. Thanks for joining me.
Thank you. It's always my pleasure.
And my privilege to, you know, to at the same time to have you live with me. And I'm sure that, you know, this yoga session is going to benefit every person who is going to watch this. And even if they're able to grab a percent of this, you know, justice is done to their fitness. And that's what the fitness of life is. Thank you so much. And once again, Namaskaram. Happy Ganesh Chaturthi.
Namaste.
Thank you, everyone. Thanks.
Happy Ganesh Chaturthi.
Thank you.
Thank you, Arimit. Enjoy your day.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thanks. Bye.
Bye-bye.